Hello and welcome to Newsclick. We have with us Dr. Gopalakrishnan, who's been the former chairman of Atomic Energy Regulatory Board and one of our leading nuclear experts. Gopal, the Fukushima disaster really brings out the importance of nuclear safety and the independence of the regulator. Because one of the problems that TEPCO had was the regulators were too cozy with TEPCO. There are a lot of issues that have come out now which were hidden, and effectively safety was underplayed by the regulator. In India, we have a worse problem. We have a regulator who is essentially subservient to the Atomic Energy Commission. Do you think that any country which wants a nuclear energy program of a large size, this is a healthy situation?
Not at all. And actually, ever since 1995, I myself have been more or less on a crusade to make AERB independent from the Department of Atomic Energy. There was once a small committee set up by Dr. Ramana and Abdul Kalam and others. And they very quickly, within a few days, came out with a result saying that no, there is no need for any change. It was really not examined properly at all. But I think Fukushima brings it back into focus. And how only a detailed analysis subsequently will show this partial subservience of regulator, which was seen in the Japanese case also, to what extent it has really hurt the situation there, and that will be worth examining, but it is too early to do that. In this country, certainly, as you said, the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board is directly reporting to the Secretary, DAE, and as such, it is formally, it is not independent. That is quite clear. Interestingly, India has signed the Convention on Nuclear Safety, and they ratified it in 2005. And Section 8.2 of the Convention very clearly says that the country who is a member should have a regulatory agency which should be totally independent from the promotional agency. In our case, the DAE is the promotional agency. And by the way, I was chairman of the drafting committee of that convention at that time. And this was the consensus of not only the developing nations, but many of the developing countries welcomed this. And it was actually the push from the developing countries which really included this Article 8. And I distinctly remember that the Sri Lankan representative was very much pushing for it. And when after this clause was put in, he said, now we can breathe easy because you're building Kulankulam reactors there. And at least we can now hope that your regulator will independently look at it. But sad to tell him today that situation has not changed. We have entered into the convention, but our regulator is still not independent. Hopefully the government is seized with this. And what I understand is that at least cosmetically they may make a separation. But what I would be closely watching is after that separation is made, whether indeed behavioral changes do take place in the AERB or not, that they, if they are going to act even without that link formally, they still continue the old habit of acting like a lapdog of the Department of Atomic Energy, then I think people like us will really get after the AERB to make sure that they operate independently. And there are various signals of when somebody starts operating independently. You can see minutes of their safety meetings, reviews, etc., on their websites. Otherwise, we'll insist you should put it there
because basically
transparency, and the public should know what they are doing, including the problems that they are citing and problems they are finding and what solutions they are doing, etc., should be there.
Earlier also, we have two major accidents that we know of. Maybe there have been more. One is a Kaiga dome collapse, and the second was a fire in Narora, where actually the reactor was shut down virtually manually by the workers and technicians over there. Now, both are effectively very serious accidents and do show that there are regulatory oversights in this sense that have taken place. Has any change taken place with respect to Atomic Energy Commission or the AERB after these two major accidents?
Not much at all, Prabir. What has happened is, even at that time, in spite of reports, accident investigation reports, which clearly brought out the failures which took place, the Department of Atomic Energy as well as the Atomic Energy Commission sort of brushed it to the side. They didn't deny it, but they accepted the report but did not take much of any action based on that report. For one thing, you know, the crew in Narora who really saved a meltdown on that reactor. It speaks also very highly of the kind of training that the PHWR engineers have received in this country. And I had recommended from the AERB that these people should be rewarded in some way. But the Department of Atomic Energy's response was that if we set them apart like that, then it will look like we are admitting something very horrible was about to happen there, which was really the case. But, you know, these kind of things really were uppermost in their mind rather than encouraging people who have taken safety actions, etc. Same happened in the same contractor who made a lot of the mistakes in the Kaiga Dome. Just after that, they continued to work on not only that project, but many other projects as if nothing has happened. So I think one doesn't see from the AEC side and the Atomic Energy Department side any corrective action or even a corrective thinking in that direction. And that is continuing even today. And this will have to go. And once an AERB is made independent, I think their punitive powers will also have to be increased so that the chairman and board of the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board should be able to impose heavier fines and fines and even you know, suspending people, etc., or dismissing people should be within the powers of the AERB, like many others.
Coming back to the issue of the nuclear energy policy in this country, one of the major problems has been the targets for nuclear energy have been decided politically. There really was no examination, how much do we need, what is the cost, what should the unit size, any of these issues were not really examined. All that happened was we had a nuclear deal between India and the United States. The Prime Minister therefore said we must have X number of X thousand megawatts installed in certain number of years, and these four major countries should be given four nuclear parks. That's been really the crux of the policies we seem to have followed. Do you think that this kind of policy, which is driven essentially from the top, is really in the long run healthy for either the country or the nuclear energy sector?
Not at all. Actually, what you said is a very good summary of what exactly happened during the Indo-US nuclear deal days. The Americans were promised 10,000 megawatt, and Sarkozy of France even succeeded in specifying that EPRs are the ones we should buy. Otherwise, there were other excellent French reactors which, if based on techno-economics, we would have picked some other reactor of France, if at all we had to go to France. So, but France was very badly looking for markets for the EPR, having spent so much money in its development. And our Prime Minister was made to agree to that as a purchasing of six EPRs as a condition for France helping us with NSG. So it's really politically driven program which is coming. And now you see all the problems which it is going to raise. A reactor which has never been, EPR for example, has never been built anywhere, even till today. And we have already signed an agreement to build two of them. I think it does not make any technical sense at all. And as far as economics is concerned, this whole question of economy of size is not there at all, because it's going to cost about 20, at least minimum of 20 crores per megawatt, whereas our PHWRs would cost about 8 crores per megawatt. And even a very good imported coal station will probably cost 4, 4.5, 5 crores per megawatt. So if I think if you look at the total policy, who is setting energy policy today? I think in most of these decisions that I need 40,000 megawatt of imported reactors to avoid an energy electricity shortage in 2050. That's the theme one keeps hearing from the department. Who got this? I mean, who appointed the DAE to be the energy policy makers of the country? I mean, there are other ministries like Ministry of Power, there's Ministry of Renewable Energy Sources, there's Ministry of Coal, all these people. There has been, I've never seen a single discussion between all these ministries in a technical level to really sit down and discuss this. Prime Minister seems to have some kind of a committee under him, which is an energy policy committee or something. It has a fancy name. But it turned out that policy committee was created actually about a week before the Prime Minister went to America in July 2005. And that committee's only function was ultimately to rubber stamp that we need this kind of a deal and we need this kind of reactor imports for this. And having done that, the committee seems to have wound up because they, we don't see any action from there. So I think the whole thing is to attain certain political objectives. We are moving in certain directions. This could already, it is very clear this is going to lead to problem, and Fukushima should be a turning point where we should go back and look at these policies again. One other element of this policy is, what is the true energy demand? This, we are working on some sort of artificial notion that India should have 6,000 kilowatt hour per person per year in the year 2050. Now, this is a number which is plucked from the sky. One builds up these things sector-wise to see how much power you would require, electricity you would require, how much you can conserve, how much you can save. All this comes into that determination. So only after realistically determining what your demand is, then only you should start apportioning in what energy mix you want. And we have not done any of these things.
That, in fact, the only calculation done is till 2032. Which has been done by the Planning Commission. Coming back to the issue that you raised earlier, that this ad hoc policy measures being taken, we've also seen very close correspondence or very close relationship between the Department of Atomic Energy, the people who are taking decisions, and the vendors. And this really came about because of the political nature of the deals that were being signed, both with the United States and the French, and even with the Russians. So effectively, what we see is the distance that should have been there between the vendor and the buyer seems to have disappeared, with the common intention of convincing the Indian people about the need for nuclear power and large amounts of it.
Yes, I think, as you rightly said, you know, normally in a in the correct atmosphere, the seller and buyer should be facing each other and going through hard negotiations to pin down what the cost should be, what should be the terms of terms and conditions of purchase should be, and also what particular technical features they should have and what liability questions are to be input. Now, today we get an impression that this is all they sit together and sort of engineer it together in a closed room rather than have an open discussion. I don't know, other than these, whether any representatives from the finance, independent representatives from the finance ministry or other agencies are involved in these discussions, it doesn't know. This leads you to the major difficulty that there is no reason why the civilian nuclear sector should be under the Official Secrets Act. Even today, after all these years, you know, we are maintaining that, whereas this whole sector is completely open. We are talking about a sector which about which IAEA knows everything, and the Americans know even more about it because of the Indo-US deal. So I think it is only hidden from the Indian public to a great extent. I think we should knock it off, and one of the primary changes which are required is that civilian nuclear sector, like NTPC's power stations or hydropower stations, should be out of this. Certainly, in making it, taking it out from the Official Secrets Act, certain things like the layout of the plant, etc., which may come in handy for a terrorist organization to attack that. After all, there are France is having a very open regulation of a civilian sector. The Americans, the NRC, is doing that. And the only change after 9/11 that the NRC website has is that they removed some of the detailed drawings of the reactors and layout, etc. They had went all out for public information. They had put cutaway sections, you know, layouts of pipes and all that in the website. All those they removed because with internal collusion, somebody can break a pipe, somebody can do something to that reactor. So they have sifted through to make sure that nothing useful for a terrorist action on that installation, and the rest of the things open, including the minutes of every single meeting they have, the deficiencies they have pointed out, the answers which came from the operator, everything is visible there for people to read. And that should be the situation here too.
Both safety and economics of the nuclear power have absolutely no reason to be put under either the official secrets or be kept away from the people. So what we really need for a proper nuclear energy sector would be A, transparency on the safety issues, and transparency on economics, on what basis we are reaching this.
In short, every country worth its name is, at least in the nuclear sector, they are being extremely transparent, because they feel that transparency is at the heart of minimizing risk, at the heart of getting opinions from as wide a segment of people as possible, because you cannot run a nuclear program these days, especially without the complete cooperation of the local communities around who surround this facility. Because I think many of the problems come from surrounding communities and people there, and I think you cannot have a conflict situation existing in any nuclear site, present or future, between local communities and the management of that facility. And we are moving in diametrically the opposite direction. Every site of ours has now opposition building, and they write it off as political, but it is not political. I think people are becoming wiser. They are aware of how the rest of the world operates, and they can clearly see that this government is not being transparent, and it leads to the right kind of suspicions that there is corruption going on here, that there are probably deficiencies in this plant which are being covered up, etc. Now, one should remove these kind of, if indeed there is no corruption and indeed there is nothing technically to be covered up, then I think it will be the wisest thing that the Atomic Energy Department and the government of India can do, is to make it totally transparent.
Thanks, Gopal. I think this has been a very interesting discussion, and we'll come back on a lot of these issues in the next few months.
You.